Now, Stephen, I want you to comment on both of those. First of all, Richard Dawkins, and then what you saw in terms of the cell there. And then I want you to give me the main thesis, the main argument that you have for intelligent design. And then we're going to look at the objections that have been raised against that, and I want you to answer them. But start us off.
Well, what you're getting from Dawkins in this quote is the standard 19th century Darwinian perspective, which is that there is an undirected process called natural selection that can mimic the powers of a designing intelligence, and thereby, as he put it, explain everything in the living world. Now, that is hotly contested today in modern biology. In the 19th century, what Darwin was able to explain was modest, small-scale variation. We've got lots of examples of that that show that natural selection is a real process that can produce real effects, like the finch beaks that get a little bigger, a little smaller, that change their shape in response to different environmental conditions, and in the process cause different varieties of finches to be better adapted to their environment. But there's lots of things that natural selection and random mutation may not be able to explain. And in biological evolution, there's lots of doubt now about whether the process can explain the big changes in life, the fundamentally new forms of life that arise in the history of life, like birds in the first place. But even if you accept that Darwinian evolution can account for this large-scale evolutionary change, there's an even more fundamental problem that Dawkins himself has acknowledged, and that is the origin of the first life. Darwin never attempted to explain it, and Dawkins has acknowledged publicly that there is no adequate undirected evolutionary mechanism to explain the origin of the first life. So every living thing in the world has not been explained by undirected mechanisms or natural selection, and in particular, what we now know is that it hasn't explained the origin of information. And that's the key problem at the root of the origin of life, and that's what is the real problem that Dawkins hasn't addressed. The argument I'm making is that the information that's encoded in the DNA molecule points decisively to an intelligent cause, not an undirected natural process. And let me relate that to Dawkins's attempt to explain away design. Let's just imagine some different types of gardens. You could have something that's kind of overgrown and may have been produced by just the natural scattering of seeds. Or what if you had a garden that's chock full of information? I actually had that experience a couple of years ago where I was going into Victoria Harbor where there was a hillside with red and yellow flowers. It caught my attention. I whipped off my glasses, took a closer look, and immediately realized that a gardener had been at work. This was intelligent design that was at work, because it wasn't just a random scatter of red and yellow flowers. It was a garden that was full of information. In fact, the flowers spelled out the message, "Welcome to Victoria." Now, Dawkins talks about an appeal to common sense. Well, what he's really talking about is a principle of reasoning that Darwin himself used, that when we're trying to explain an event in the remote past, we should be looking for a cause which is known to produce the effect in question. Neither natural selection acting on random mutations or any other undirected mechanism has accounted for the origin of the information necessary to produce the first life. And yet we know that life is full of information, like that garden in Victoria, or we actually saw the way the information directs the construction of proteins in that animation you showed a minute ago. So we're not looking at just kind of a random and disorganized garden. We're looking at one that's chock full of information. And what we know from experience is that information always comes from an intelligent source. There's an information scientist who made the observation that information is habitually associated with conscious activity. Well, that's a correct observation based on our experience, which is the basis of all scientific reasoning, but it has stunning implications when we start to talk about DNA. Bill Gates has said that DNA is like a software program, only much more complex than any we've ever created. That's the garden chock full of information. Now, that's suggestive because we know from experience that it takes a programmer to make a program. We know generally that information always comes from an intelligent source, whether we're talking about an arrangement of flowers, or a headline in a newspaper, or a paragraph in a book, or a hieroglyphic inscription like on the Rosetta Stone, for example. or information embedded in a radio signal. Whenever we see information and we trace it back to its source, we always come to an intelligence, not an undirected process. Now, neither Dawkins nor anyone else working on evolutionary biology has been able to offer an alternative explanation for information. Yeah, sure, there's minor adaptations that we know natural selection can produce, but the fundamental changes in life, which require information, and especially the origin of life itself, which requires information in the form of the code in DNA, that hasn't been explained by any undirected process that can mimic the powers of a designing intelligence. Instead, the only cause we know of in the whole of the universe that can produce information is intelligence. So the discovery of information at the foundation of life is decisive evidence of actual design, of intelligent design, not an undirected process that merely mimics design.
This has been an ATRI production.